الحمد لله نحمده تعالى ونستعينه ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله. بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح للأمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده. ورضى اللهم عن الصحابة والتابعين وتابعيهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. Dear brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. If I had to pick a title for today's khutbah, the most suitable title that I can think of is Lessons of Tarbiyah from the Quran, from Kitab Allah Azza wa Jal. And the reason I picked this subject, this is my first time giving khutbat al-Jum'ah in this masjid. I've given lectures before in different areas. But I feel that I have to talk about the mission of this center in order for the khutbah to be relevant. And that led me to the subject of tarbiyah. And as far back as I can remember, every time I spoke on tarbiyah, I've dedicated years of my life in serving this cause, starting with building Al Ghazali School in New Jersey together with other brothers more than 20 years ago, and a lot more work after that. As'alullah Azza wa Jal Al Qabool. But every time I think about tarbiyah, I remember the ayat from Surah Al Imran, verses 34, 35, 36, 37. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ذرية بعضها من بعض والله سميع عليم. Then Allah Azza wa Jal tells us about ابنة عمران، امرأة عمران. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إذ قالت امرأة عمران. Allah Azza wa Jal tells us about the wife of عمران, the mother of Maryam عليها السلام. رب إني نذرت لك ما في بطني محررا فتقبل مني. There are more lessons in these آيات than an entire volume on tarbiyah. Let's pay attention. Imra'at Imran, if you read the tafsir, they say she dedicated what's in her womb. Another tafsir, Muhammad Asad, more contemporary mufassir, says she vowed. So if you put the word nadr, the Arabic word nadr, in Google Translate, the word that comes on the other side is vow. Where is vow and where is dedication from nadr? Sha'rawi rahimahullah spends two pages explaining nadr. And in brief he says, an-nadru fi shay'in mashru' wa ziyadatin alayh. In other words, you cannot make nadr to do something that is haram or to expand something that Allah Azza wa Jal described to us, like salah for instance. If Salat al-Maghrib is 3, you can't make another to make it 7. That cannot be another. That's stupidity. That's not understanding the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. But if you said Salat al-Maghrib 3, and then I'm going to pray 2 sunnah, and then at some point I'm going to pray more sunnah and more sunnah, that's fine. That's another. You can make another that I will pray every day Salat al-Duha until the day I die. That is the kind of another that's allowed. So here when she says, رَبِّ إِنِّي نَذَرْتُ لَكَ مَا فِي بَطْنِي, she is making this nadr to Allah Azza wa Jal to raise this child that's going to be born, which she didn't know if it's going to be male or female. And in the Arabic language, the word walad does not mean boy. It means mawlud. It means something born. It has nothing to do with male or female. So Maryam didn't even know what's in her womb. And she's saying, oh Allah Azza wa Jal, this child is gonna be, listen to the words, muharraran. Why does she have to say muharrar, and what does muharrar mean? Muharrar, in order for us to understand the meaning of this word, we have to remember what Sayyidina Ibrahim before her said, when he was praying to Allah Azza wa Jal, رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا الْبَلَدَ آمِنًا وَجْنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ أَنْ نَعْبُدَ الْأَصْنَامِ. He's praying to Allah Azza wa Jal to make the balad, al-balad, it has already become a community. Not like in Surah Al-Baqarah where he says, رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا. Oh Allah, make it a community. It was not a community. It was a barren land with no vegetation. It was dead. There was nothing there. So that's the difference why in Surah Al-Baqarah, رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا. بَلَدًا is nakira. It's not a balad yet. But in Surah Ibrahim, رب اجعل هذا البلد, this land, has already become, started to form as a community. And then he asked Allah Azza wa Jal to protect his children from al-Asnam. رب اجنبني وبني أن نعبد الأصنام. رب إننا أضللنا كثيرا من الناس فمن تبعني فإنه مني. Then the next ayah, here is the key. ربنا إني, and in another قراءة إني, but إني أسكنت من ذريتي بواد غير ذي زرع عند بيتك المحرم. سيدنا إبراهيم knew exactly what he wanted from his children or for his children. أبو الأنبياء صلى الله عليه وسلم is not in the same position as Maryam. Maryam is a totally different story. Abu al-Anbiya says, oh Allah, here's what I would love for my children. إِنِّي أَسْكَنْتُ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي بِوَادٍ غَيْرِ ذِي زَرْعٍ, a valley with no vegetation. فَاجْعَلْ أَفْئِدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهُوِي إِلَيْهِمْ. Let some community, let a community form. Let some people with hearts, أَفْئِدَة, not bodies only. People with hearts who respond to the da'wah of Allah Azza wa Jal, to the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal. People who will become supporters of the deen of Allah. Let them come and join them. And then he says, رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُ الصَّلَىٰ. The first responsibility, the first duty of his children, he wants it to be the establishment of the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal in the land. Number one. رَبَّنَا لِيُقِيمُ الصَّلَاةَ فَاجْعَلْ أَفِيدَةً مِنَ النَّاسِ تَهُوِي إِلَيْهِمْ. Oh, by the way, وَارْزُقْهُمْ مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ. And oh Allah, give them some food. Is that the order in which we raise our children? I blame myself before I blame any of you. I've been in this country for 38 years. And some of us have been here longer. And if you asked them what was top on their mind the day they landed in JFK or wherever they landed, Ellis Island or Allah knows where, first thing on their mind was, how can I feed my kids? Wouldn't it have been nicer if we said, oh Allah, رب اجعلني مقيم الصلاة. And then Allah Azza wa Jal takes care of everything else. Subhanallah. That's when we have absolute belief in Allah Azza wa Jal, absolute faith in the ability of Allah. We'll see later on when she says, يرزق من يشاء بغير حساب. إن الله يرزق من يشاء بغير حساب. هنالك دعا زكريا ربه. When he absolutely recognized and realized that giving sustenance to Maryam is not a big deal, it is within the absolute power of Allah Azza wa Jal that came to his attention. That subhanAllah, maybe I should ask Allah Azza wa Jal for a child. We'll come to that later. So here, muharraran, because as in Sayyidina Ibrahim knew exactly what he wanted. Maryam, Imra'at Imran, all she wanted for her child is to be free. Muharrar from hur. Hur means not a slave. Not bonded, not bound by the rules and regulations, customs and tradition of the society. She wanted her to be something else. She wanted this child to be a servant of Allah Azza wa Jal, not in the tradition of her qawm. She wanted something different because it's another. If it was something consistent with what everybody else said, what does everybody do? Everybody gets children and then they want for them what we want for our children. قُرَّةَ عَيْنٍ لِي. They want them to be a source of comfort and relaxation. They want them to be all kinds of things. We want them to be doctors and lawyers, and we want them to make a lot of money, and we want them to have a big house and a good car and a good wife and children. A million and a half things. That's what we want. إِمْرَأَةَ عِمْرَانَ said, oh Allah Azza wa Jal, none of that. مُحَرَّرًا. Free from all of that everybody wants. She wants her to be something else. And she says, فَتَقَبَّلْ مِنِّي. Oh Allah, accept from me. For the sake of Allah and nothing else. So she, right from the beginning, Maryam was going to be something special. Something that is not defined by the norms of the society that they lived in. I give credit to this analogy to Sheikh Sha'rawi, rahimahullah. I don't want anybody to think I'm that smart. So Sheikh Sha'rawi says that, and then when you pay attention to the words, you see, first of all, that she says Rabbi, addressing Rabbul Alameen with his attribute of Rabb, brings our attention to tarbiyah. Had she said Ya Allah, the attention would have gone to the worship, that she is going to be a worshiper of Allah. But here she's asking Allah Azza wa Jal to give her a child who is going to receive special tarbiyah. So the more proper term, the more proper attribute of رب العالمين here would be ربي. ربي إني نذرت لك ما في بطني محررا فتقبل مني إنك أنت السميع العليم. Notice the ayah before that. ذرية بعضها من بعض. الله سميع عليم. سميع عليم here, سميع عليم. As if she heard that Allah is سميع عليم. So she says, يا سميع يا عليم. She's addressing Allah Azza wa Jal the way he wants to be addressed. He says, I am Sami Alim. She says, Ya Sami Ya Alim. Give me a child that will be, subhanAllah. The best way to address Allah is the way Allah wants to be addressed, subhanAllah. Ya Sami Ya Alim. فتقبل مني. فلما وضعتها, when she gave birth to Maryam, قالت ربي إني وضعتها أنثى. Obviously, she didn't know. She thought it was going to be a boy that she can dedicate to the service of the temple, which is what everybody wants. But then there is a sentence here in Arabic, it's called جملة معترضة. والله أعلم بما وضعت. Is she telling Allah that something he doesn't know? حاشا لله. What she is saying, I recognize this may not fulfill my nether because she had thought she would have a boy. And then the ayah after that, the remaining of the ayah, والله أعلم بما وضعت وليس الذكر كالأنثى. Sheikh Sharawi rahimahullah says, and the male is not like female. Wait a minute, are these the words of Maryam or the words of Allah Azza wa Jal? Because the phrase before that confuses us a little bit. We're not sure if these are the words, if Maryam is continuing her conversation with Rabbil Alameen, her supplication, or is it Rabbil Alameen answering Maryam when she says, Rabbi inni wada'tuha untha. So Rabbil Alameen says, وَلَيْسَ الذَّكَرُ الْأُنْثَى. She's going to have a child. His name is going to be Isa, and he's going to lead the world and change the whole world, not just this few square feet of temple that you wanted him for. So Allah wanted a lot more. Had he been a boy, he would not give birth to Isa. He would have been just another boy who would serve the temple and be a good servant of Allah Azza wa Jalla. وليس الذكر كالأنثى. As if it is a promise from Rabbil Alameen that this Untha, this Maryam, is going to have an amazing, amazing story that's going to be with us until the Day of Judgment. That's if we assume or if we believe that these are the words of Allah Azza wa Jal. If it is the words of Maryam, then the meaning is more limited, which is, oh Allah, she can't do what a boy can do, so what am I going to do now, basically. Sheikh Sha'rawi nominates the second interpretation, which is that these are the words of Allah Azza wa Jal telling Maryam that there is going to be the affair of Maryam, telling Imra'at Imran that Maryam is going to be special. Wallahu a'lam. And then she says, وَإِنِّي أُعِيذُهَا بِكَ وَذُرِّيَّتَهَا مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. She seeks protection of Allah Azza wa Jal for Maryam and her offspring. Let's pay attention here. فَتَقَبَّلَهَا رَبُّهَا بِقَبُولٍ حَسَنٍ. Allah Azza wa Jal graciously accepted Maryam. Yes. وَأَنْبَتَهَا نَبَاتًا حَسَنًا. Sheikh Sha'rawi says, Rahimahullah, says, قَبُول مَرْيَمْ وَأَنْبَاتْ مَرْيَمْ. Accepting her and nurturing her, Allah Azza wa Jal took it upon himself to take care of that. وَكَفَّلَهَا زَكَرِيَّا. كَفَالَتْ زَكَرِيَّا. That the fact that Zakariya is going to be her protector and her guardian is only to fulfill the promise of Allah Azza wa Jal. In other words, he is just a tool in the hands of Allah Azza wa Jal. The real nurturing, anbataha. Brothers, pay attention, sisters, pay attention to the word anbataha. Nabat is plant. If you're a farmer, your job is to take a seed, put it in the ground, give it water, make sure the soil is healthy, and you pay attention to it. It becomes a seedling. You keep an eye on it. You make sure the wind doesn't blow it, the insects don't eat it, the birds don't eat it. You have to do a million and a half things so that this nabta grows to become a tree. That's exactly how Allah Azza wa Jal described the raising of Maryam. Like a nabta, like a plant, coming right out of the ground. أَنْبَتَهَا نَبَاتًا حَسَنًا. Really good upbringing. And that's the subject of the khutbah today. What exactly did Zakariya do in response to the responsibility that Allah Azza wa Jal gave him? And of course, we're not going to go into how Zakariya was chosen and all the commotion that happened around that, and how Allah Azza wa Jal says to the leaders of the community, leave Maryam alone, Zakariya is going to take care of her. That's another subject. The important thing here is that Zakariya became in charge. He became the guardian. And this is to bring our attention that every one of our children needs a guardian. Children cannot be left alone. they need inbat. They need to be raised as if they were a plant. Wallahi, some of us probably, and I'm not saying majority, wal'iyadu billah, no. But some people that live in the world today, doesn't have to be Muslims, probably pay more attention to a plant than they do to a child. Some pay more attention to dogs and cats than they do to children. The child, from the moment he wakes up, I've seen children sit for hours in front of the computer screen, playing games for hours and hours and hours and hours. That's like planting a plant and leaving it. Where is the responsibility? Where is the kafala here? كفلها زكريا. What did Zakaria do? Let's look at some lessons here. كلما دخل عليها زكريا المحراب. In other words, she had, every time he entered her chamber, she had a chamber. She had a good environment. She had a good place to live in. وجد عندها رزقا. He saw some sustenance. And here, Sheikh Sha'rawi brings up a very important issue, the issue of accountability. You see your child coming in with something he can't afford. You are responsible to ask and say, من أين لك هذا? Where did this come from? If you know that your child cannot afford a $100 toy, his allowance is $2 a week or a day or whatever the amount of money you give him, and all of a sudden he brings home an Xbox or something, it costs hundreds of dollars. And you just say, okay. This ayah teaches us, كلما وجد عندها رزقا قال أنى لك هذا. Sustenance, something you know everybody should have. But he wasn't aware how it was coming about. And she's in her chambers. In other words, she's not out there, out and about, buying and selling. She's protected. أنى لك هذا. قالت هو من عند الله. إن الله يرزق من يشاء بغير حساب. So as we read these ayat and many other ayat, we start paying attention to some lessons. I'll go over them briefly, inshallah, after the dua. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم في فوز المستغفرين. استغفر الله. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. أما بعد. So here are some lessons that you learn from these ayat and other ayat and also from life. I kind of like put them together. I recently gave them to a brother of ours at UCLA who was applying for a job on change. And the company that he is applying for specializes in change management. So I said, SubhanAllah, change as in tarbiyah. So I gave him 8 points that I'm going to share with you on how you can change somebody for the better. He put it together in a beautifully written article. I'd be happy to share it with Imam Muhammad Mathil or anybody here, and you can read it. That article got him this job in one very famous company. And they actually told him they thought he had an MBA. He didn't. He has a BA just because of the beautiful article. The entire article was written based on the few points that I'm going to mention to you. Number one, that most behavior is influenced by tradition and habit. Most of our behavior, and that's why she said muharraran, she wanted her child to be free from bondage to tradition and habits. She wants her to do the right thing. She wants her to grow the right way. Many of our children are raised by tradition, and that sometimes could be good, sometimes could be bad. If you are living in an Islamic environment, as we will see later, that actually could be a plus. If you're living in an environment that purports and supports individual freedom to an extent that is unacceptable in the eyes of Allah Azza wa Jal, where a child at a certain age says, leave me alone, I choose to do whatever I want to do, I see that with my own eyes. I've seen it in my own family, I've seen it in relatives and friends and so on. So that is definitely one big problem. In addition, even for somebody who wants to change himself for the better, many times we fall prey to habit. And one of the great blessings of Ramadan, I wish this khutbah was on Ramadan, I would have discussed this at great length. One of the great blessings of Ramadan is that in these 29 or 30 days, we have an opportunity to change habit. They say it is required to change a bad habit to a better habit. It is required anywhere from, they say, 15 to 30 days. So subhanAllah, this is one of the gifts of Ramadan, is that it gives us the ability to change. To change bad behavior to good behavior. But most of our behavior is driven by habit. The other thing, and of course, the Quran records that in Surah Al-Ma'idah, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَهُمْ تَعَالَوْا إِلَى مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ وَالرَّسُولُ وَإِلَى الرَّسُولُ قالوا حسبنا ما وجدنا عليه آباءنا. In several places in the Quran, every time the messengers talk to the people to come to the path of Allah Azza wa Jal, their response is, هذا ما وجدنا عليه آباءنا. This is how we found our parents doing. In other words, this is force of habit. We've been doing it for hundreds of years. What do you want to change us for? And even among good intentioned Muslims, one time I was saying to somebody about Sunnatul Jum'ah, for instance, and I'm not making any judgment here. I said, why do you pray Sunnah before Jum'ah? I was not talking about Tahiyyat al-Masjid, the specific Sunnah, that the Adhan and Sunnah. You know what he said to me? He said, well, that's what we used to do in Masjid al-Aqsa. I said, do you have a Dalil? I mean, I'd really like to learn. I wasn't arguing with him. I want to learn. Where did you get that from? He said, but that's what we did in Masjid al-Aqsa. People consider هذا ما وجدنا عليه أبانا. This is how our parents used to do it to be somehow evidence of correctness. And it may be and it may not be. So here, that's the first challenge that we have in raising our children is to deal with, or even in changing ourselves, is to deal with force of habit. The second thing is, let's pay attention to وَكَفَّلَهَا زَكَرِيَّا. This brings our attention to a very important part of our society that we don't have for the most part. And the people who have it are lucky to have it. And that is the power of mentorship. Mentoring, brothers if you and sisters, if you pay attention to the greatest scholars of Islam, whether we're talking about Ibn Qayyim, Ibn Taymiyyah, Ibn Kathir, many, many of the great scholars, even Al-Bukhari, Shafi'i, Abu Hanifa, the greatest scholars in Islam, every one of them is known by his mentor. Every one of them had a mentor. Every one of them had a source to receive from. Not simply somebody to give a lecture and walk away, but somebody who stayed with them for years and years and years. That allowed the tarbiyah process to take its to their hold and to raise these people to where they need to be. So there is a shortage of mentors in the Western society. They refer to them as coaches, consultants. People pay them tons of money to show them the way. And they empower them to tell them what to do, from sports figures to just about everybody. Third, most people live a life without a mission. We all know from Surah Al-Baqarah, قَالَ رَبُّكَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. Khalifa, that's your job on this earth. Khalifa is to establish the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal, is to live in accordance with the deen of Allah Azza wa Jal, and yet most people have no clue. And no clue what they're on this earth. I once asked a brother, I said, why are you on this planet? Can you give me an answer? He looked at me with this blank one-mile stare, and he's like, Wallahi, I don't know. I have no idea. I never thought about it. I'm just here. I'm just here. And there are a lot of people that feel that way. I used to teach a course called Quantum Leap. I taught it here a couple of times. And it's about life purpose, living life on purpose. And I used to ask the students, does anybody have any definite idea why you are on this planet? I'm not talking about just Muslims, non-Muslims too. Last class I taught in Colorado, 400 people were present, and hardly any of them had a good answer for why they are on this earth. They're just here, and they're going to continue on this path until one day they drop dead from a heart attack or whatever, and then they're gone, and that's it. And if you write their story, you don't know what to put on their tombstone, because you have no idea why they were here in the first place. Because if you knew, you would say, so-and-so lived for, and then you put it in, whatever it is that they lived for. Subhanallah. The next thing is that there is a diminishing role of culture and tradition. A good culture could help the parents raise their children. There is a lack of a supporting environment. We said, أَنْبَتَهَا نَبَتًا حَسَنًا means that Allah Azza wa Jal put Sayyidina Zakaria in charge to develop her every stage of her life. That in bad. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warns about this and says, كل إنسان يولد على الفطرة. Everybody is born according to fitra, and his parents either turn him Christian, Jew, Majusi. They do all kinds of things. That is the force of the environment. Change requires a lot of energy, especially in the beginning. Try to ask anybody who wanted to change, whether to get rid of a bad habit, talk to addicts, smokers, people like that. You'll see that most of the power that's needed to kick that habit was required in the very early stages. And that you and I cannot do alone. There is a need to have somebody there, a mentor, a coach, a big brother, somebody there to help in the process. Number seven, this is a big one. Too many distractions. Too many distractions. Just pay attention to yourself or to anybody around you, and you'll see that most of the times, we don't get things done because there's other things that need to get done, and then you wind up with a long list of to-do. And tomorrow I'm going to be teaching a time management course in Milwaukee. The first point I'm going to say to them is, time management is about what you don't do, not what you do. If you learn how to say no to a lot of garbage that jumps on your daily planner, if you learn how to do that, then you'll do much better. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one who taught me this principle, where he says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man ja'ala al-hamma hamman wahidan kafahu Allahu humum ad-dunya wal-akhirah. Anyone who narrows his concerns and issues and challenges to the few important ones and does not worry about the unimportant little things, then he'll do much better. That's one of the reasons why tarbiyah is so difficult. And last but not least, most people attempt big change instead of incremental change. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one hadith tells us, "Inna al-munbattala ardan qata'a wa la dhahran abqa." He says, be careful. Don't be like the traveler who pushes his horse so hard that he kills the horse and he doesn't go far. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وإسرافنا في أمرنا. اللهم تقبل منا صلاتنا وصيامنا وزكاتنا. يا ربي لك الحمد كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك وعظيم سلطانك. صلي اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم انصر الإسلام وأعز المسلمين. اللهم أعلي بفضلك وكرمك كلمتي الحق والدين. اللهم انصر إخواننا المجاهدين في كل مكان. اللهم احقن دم إخواننا في سوريا وفي بورما وفي كافة بقاع الأرض يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم يا رب كن عونا لهم وانصرهم على أعدائهم واحقن دماءهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم حرر المسجد الأقصى. اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. عباد الله، إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم واستغفروه يغفر لكم. إن شاء الله after the salah, I'm going to ask you to stay with me for about 5 minutes inshallah. We're going to talk about this center and this khutbah is not for nothing. I meant to bring to your attention the importance of having a place like this one and your role in supporting it, inshallah. Jazakum Allah khairan. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.